الحمد لله رب العالمين إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد بن عبد الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار Inshallah ta'ala, we're going to be starting a tafsir series. And we're going to be starting from Surah Al-Ghashiyah until Surah Al-Nas, Inshallah ta'ala. But today, bi-idhnillah al-kareem, we're going to start the tafsir with a lecture. And this will be, Inshallah ta'ala, on the topic of what method does one take if he wants to attain the knowledge of the Qur'an? If one wants to attain the knowledge of the Qur'an, what is it that he or she should do? So I'm not going to be speaking about how to do tafsir, but what I will be speaking about is how to attain the knowledge and the steps that you should take if you want to learn tafsir. And inshallah ta'ala, it will be the method that each and every class that we have, I will be using bi-idhnillah al-kareem. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He willed to create Nabiullah Adam, and to make him a governor on this earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He spoke to the angels. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said to the angels, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةٌ I'm going to make a governor on this earth. And so the angels responded, and they said to Allah Azza wa Jal, قَالُوا أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءِ وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ The angels, they said two things. The first thing that they said was, are you going to create a creation who will bring about corruption? They will spill blood and they would come with wrongdoings. And the second thing that they mentioned was that which they will come with, that which the angels themselves do, which is, O Allah, وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ We exalt you, and we praise you, and we glorify you. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He responded and He said to them, قَالَ إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ I know that which you do not know, and I have knowledge of that which you don't have knowledge of. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows مَا كَان, that which was. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He knows مَا سَيَكُونُ, that which is going to happen. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He also knows ma huwa ka'inun, that which is happening at that moment. And He also knows that which hasn't happened, if it was to happen, the way that it would happen. So His knowledge is vast, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so Allah responded to the angels by telling them, inni a'lamu ma la ta'lamun. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He created Adam in Jannah. And Allah placed Adam in a place that was close to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala favored Adam. And he told the angels to prostrate to Adam, and they all prostrated to him, except Shaytan, who chose to go against Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's command. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he told Adam to eat from every other place in this garden, but to stay away from this particular tree. And Adam went against Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's command, and he ate from the tree. And then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he told him and his wife Hawa to descend. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said to them, قُلْ نَهْبِطُ مِنْهَا جَمِيعًا. All of you go down now. And Adam, he came to this earth for the first time. And Adam passed away, and 10 centuries came after him, and Tawheed was still consistent and continuous. As Abdullah ibn Abbas mentioned in Athar, which Imam al-Bukhari narrated in his Sahih. 10 centuries came, and the people were upon monotheism, or the people were upon Tawheed, and they were worshipping Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Then the people deviated from that path. As Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he says, كَانَ النَّاسُ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا. The people were one. They were upon one way. They were upon one path. They didn't deviate from that way. But when they did, فَبَعَثَ اللَّهُ النَّبِيِّينَ مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ. When the people turned away from that path, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent prophets. And the first of them was Nabiullahi Nuh. Nabiullahi Nuh came and he called the people and told them to stay away from the idol worshipping. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he told us, وَقَالُوا لَا تَذَرُنَّ آلِهَتَكُمْ وَلَا تَذَرُنَّ وَدًّا وَلَا سُوَاعًا وَلَا يَغُوثَ وَيَعُوقَ. These were five righteous people that they were worshipping. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he sent prophets from them. I mean, the first of them was Nabiullahi Nuh. Nuh came with two things, Mubashirina wa Mundirin. He was given the ones who followed him glad tidings. And the ones who went against his command, he warned them. And what did he warn them about? The punishment of Allah that will come their way if they go against Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's religion. وَأَنْزَلَ مَعْهُمُ الْكِتَابِ. And this prophet, he was a messenger, and he came with a message. So a messenger was sent with a message. And the message was through a book. And what was this book used? وَأَنْزَلَ مَعْهُمُ الْكِتَابَ بِالْحَقِّ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ فِي مَا اخْتَلَفُوا فِيهِ. This book was used whenever dispute and argumentations happen between the people, this book will judge them. And this book will bring them salvation and prosperity. And Nabiullah Nuh, he called his people to it. And he called them for 950 years. And they didn't follow him. Allah said in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ فَلَبِسَ فِيهِمْ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ إِلَّا خَمْسِينَ عَامًا. Nuh stayed with his people and called them to Tawheed for 950 years, and the amount that followed him were those who can go on a ark. That's all that followed Nabiullahi Nuh. And that doesn't mean the message of Nuh was wrong and his method was wrong. Rather, Nuh's message and his method were both praiseworthy. But Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he guides whoever he wills. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. 70 nations completed and Ummah Muhammad came. فعند الترمذي, الإمام الترمذي, he narrated بسنده from his chain and حديثي, the hadith of بهز بن معاوية عن أبيه عن جده, that the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, إنكم, you all, تتمون 70 أمة. You will complete 7 nations. Antum khayruha, you're the best of those nations. Wa akramuha, and you are the most honorable of nations that have ever come. Ummah Muhammad is the best of those nations. And they are the most beloved nation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nabiullah Muhammad, he came to take us out of two things that were present in us. Allah mentions it in the ayah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, إنا عرضنا الأمانة على السماوات والأرض والجبال فأبين أن يحملنها وأشفقن منها وحملها الإنسان إنه كان ظلوما جهولا. Two characteristics were present in us, and two characteristics are apparent in us, and Nabiullah Muhammad came to remove those two characteristics from us, which is ignorance and oppression. Allah said in the Quran, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. This Prophet came to take us out of the clear-cut misguidance that we were in. And how did he want to take us out of this misguidance? In which way he came to take us out of this misguidance and also this oppression that is with us? In two ways. يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ. He's reading the Qur'an on them. And also doing what? وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. And he's teaching them what? He's teaching them the Qur'an and the Sunnah. So through the Qur'an and the Sunnah, the darkness that we were in and the misguidance that we were in, we were taken out of. This Qur'an that we have, my beloved brothers and sisters, is the best of books, as our messenger is the best of messengers. This book is the best of books, and it's the book that guides us to the best of affairs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمْ. This book, it guides to the best of affairs. And also this Qur'an, this book, it cures us from the two types of illness that we may face. The illness of the body and the illness of the heart. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ. We have sent this book down as a cure. The cure of what? The cure of the heart. From what illness can the heart suffer from? أَمْرَاضِ الشَّهَوَاتِ وَالشُّبُهَاتِ. The illnesses of doubts and the illness of desires. This Qur'an is there to remove it. And the illnesses of our bodies. If we have any physical illness, the Qur'an will what? The Qur'an will cure us based on that verse, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. This Qur'an is what's going to take us on the straight path. And it's what's going to give us life. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, وَأَنزَلْنَا. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, وَكَذَلِكَ أُوحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ رُوحًا مِّنْ أَمْرِنَا مَا كُنْتَ تَدْرِي مَا الْكِتَابُ وَلَا الْإِيمَانِ وَلَكِنْ جَعَلْنَاهُ نُورًا نَهْدِي بِهِ مَنْ نَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا وَإِنَّكَ لَتَهْدِي إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Allah told us subhanahu wa ta'ala that this Qur'an will give us life. It will give us life in this world, a real life. It will take away from us depression. It will take away from us hardship, anxieties. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, فَإِمَّا يَتِيَنَّكُم مِّنِّي هُدَى فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا يَضِلُّ وَلَا يَشْقَى وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى قَالَ رَبِّ لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا قَالَ كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا فَنَسِيتَهَا وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى فَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُم مِّنِّي هُدَى فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا يَضِلُّ وَلَا يَشْقَى. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, فَلَا يَضِلُّ أَيْ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَلَا يَشْقَى أَيْ فِي الْآخِرَةِ. In this world, you're not going to go through hardship. You're not going to have any misguidance, because the Qur'an will save you from that. And the Day of Judgment, Allah will protect you from the hellfire. And if you go against the Qur'an, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَن تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. This world, you're going to go through trials and tribulations. You're truly going to suffer. You're going to be in pain and agony. And the Day of Judgment, a severe punishment awaits you. This Qur'an, فِيهِ الْهِدَايَةُ التَّامَّةُ. In it is complete guidance. The one who wants this world, man arada dunya falyuthawwir al-Quran. Anyone who wants this dunya, let him research and look into the Quran. Wa man arada al-akhirah. And anyone who wants the akhirah, falyuthawwir al-Quran. Look at the Quran, the gems and the jewels that are in the Quran. Wa man aradahuma. And anyone who wants the akhirah and the dunya simultaneously, let him look into the Quran and give attention to the Quran, because the salvation of ours is connected to the Quran. This Quran was sent down for us to do six things with it. This Quran was sent down for us to do 6 things with it. The first of it is to read it, to read this book and to look at it. The second reason in which the Quran was sent down was to ponder over it and to contemplate over it. Allah said in the Quran, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. In another ayah, Allah says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. In another ayah, Allah says, أَفَلَمْ يَتَدَبَّرُوا الْقَوْلَ. Why do they not ponder on the Quran? Are there locks on their hearts? Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He said, why do they not ponder on the Quran? For verily, if the Quran was to come from other than Allah, you would have found inside it what? Contradiction. But because it has come from Allah, you will not find contradiction. The fourth reason, the third reason is al-amalu bihi, to implement the Quran. The reason why the Quran was sent down is not that it collects dust on the shelf, but it was sent down for you to implement it. To do what? To take the halal that the Quran made halal for you, and to stay away from the things that the Quran made haram for you, to stay away from it. But it's not something to decorate your house with, to buy a frame or a picture and write Ayatul Kursi and stick it on the wall, and you don't even know Ayatul Kursi and you don't know what it means. And every hour that goes by, you go against what Ayatul Kursi is commanding you. That is not why it was sent down. And the fourth is, وَالْحُكُمِ بِهِ وَالْتَحَاكُمِ إِلَيْهِ. When disputations, argumentations, conflicts occur, you reference the Qur'an and you go back to the Qur'an. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He told us to do this. He says, وَأَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولُو الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ فَإِنْ تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. If you believe in Allah, if you believe in the Day of Judgment, go back to the Qur'an. Allah says, وَمَا اخْتَلَفْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَحُكْمُهُ فَحُكْمُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. There is no dispute and argumentations that happen between you, except that you can take it back to where? The answer is where? It's in the book of Allah. It's in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And last but not least, the sixth is, وَالِاسْتِشْفَاءِ بِهِ, to use the Qur'an as your cure. The Qur'an is a cure. As Allah said in the ayah, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ. وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ. And this min in the ayah, it's not للتبعيد. Rather, grammatically is بَيَانُ جِنْسٍ. As Ibn al-Qayyim رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ mentioned in his kitab, الدَّاء وَالدَّوَاء. أَمَا الْجَوَابُ الْكَافِي لِمَنْ سَأَلَ عَنِ الدَّوَاءِ الشَّافِي. Those are the six reasons why the Qur'an was sent down. It is sad, wallahi, to find this book that our salvation, our prosperity of this world and the hereafter is connected to, and we don't even understand it. How are you going to enjoy this Qur'an if you don't know what it means? Al-Imam Abu Ja'far, Imam al-Mufassirin, Abi Ja'far Muhammad ibn Jarir al-Tabariyu, rahimahullah, he said, إِنِّي لَأَعْجَبُ. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari said this. He said, إِنِّي لَأَعْجَبُ, I am fascinated. مِمَّنْ يَقْرَأُ الْقُرْآنَ, a person who reads the Qur'an, وَلَمْ يَعْلَمْ تَأْوِيلَهُ, and he doesn't know the interpretation of the Qur'an. كَيْفَ يَلْتَذُّ بِقِرَاءَتِي, how can he enjoy its recitation? Ibn Jarir said this, rahimahullah. He said, إِنِّي لَأَعْجَبُ, I am fascinated. مِمَّنْ يَقْرَأُ الْقُرْآنَ, a person who's reading this book. A person who's what? Reciting this book, meaning the Qur'an. وَلَمْ يَعْلَمْ تَأْوِيلَهُ, and he doesn't know the interpretation of the Qur'an. كَيْفَ يَلْتَذُّ بِقِرَاءَتِهِ, how will he enjoy this book, and how will he find the gems that are in this book? The joy of this book is connected to what? To understand what is in it. وَلِذَلِكَ أَبُو الْعَبَّاسِ ibn تَيْمِيَةَ الْحَفِيدِ, Ibn Taymiyyah رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ, he mentioned a very powerful statement that we covered in the sharah of Muqaddimah fi Usul al-Tafsir. He said, Hajatul Ummah, the need that the Ummah have ila fahmil Qur'ani, the need that the Ummah have is massah, is very high, إلى فهم القرآن to understand the Quran. The Ummah are in great need to understand the Quran. Ibn Taymiyyah is saying this. He also said, وَكُلُّ كَلَامٍ every speech, فَالْمَقْصُودُ مِنْهُ مَعْرِفَةُ مَعَانِهِ every speech, what's the objective behind it? Is to understand the meaning of the speech. دُونَ مُجَرَّدِ أَلْفَاظِ the wording is not the intent. The intent of a person's speech is to what? Is to understand what they are saying. It's not the wording. وَلِذَلِكَ sometimes it can happen, a person says something wrong, but you understand what they are trying to say based on the meaning. For example, if somebody wants to hug you and says, come here. He hasn't said it to you. Let me hug you, right? But you've understood it. The intent behind the speech is not the wording. But what is the intent behind it? The intent behind it is, فَالْمَقْصُودُ مِنْهُ مَعْرِفَةُ مَعَانِي is to understand the meaning. If that's the intent of the speech of a human being, فَالْقُرْآنُ أَوْلَى بِذَلِكَ Ibn Taymiyyah says. The Qur'an is more befitting for somebody to give importance to its understanding and to understanding its meaning. He also said, وَالْعَادَةُ أَيْضًا تَمْنَعُ أَنْ يَقْرَأَ قَوْمٌ كِتَامًا فِي فَنٍ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ كَالطِّبِّ وَالْحِسَابِ وَلَا يَسْتَشْرِحُوهُ فَكَيْفَ بِكَلَامِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى الَّذِي هُوَ عِصْمَتُهُمْ وَبِهِ سَعَادَتُهُمْ وَنَجَاتُهُمْ وَقِيَامُ دِينِهِمْ وَدُنْيَاهُمْ Ibn Taymiyyah said, the norms and the customs of the people prevents for a person to read a book and not look for somebody to explain it for him if he doesn't understand it. You read a book, you didn't understand it. The norms, the adah will prevent you. You start looking, Akhi, can you explain this book? I don't understand it. The norms doesn't allow you to do that. If you have an exam in university or in school, you would ask somebody to explain what the teacher said if you didn't understand it. It does not make sense for you to still carry on going to that class and you haven't understood what was said. Then Ibn Taymiyyah, he said, an example for this is the academic sciences like maths and, you know, physics and science and whatever it may be. Then look what he said after that. فَكَيْفَ بِكَلَامِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى How is the book of Allah something you don't look for somebody to explain it for you? And in truth is what? The Qur'an has in it your isma, your prosperity, your infallibility is connected to this Qur'an. Here, inshallah wa ta'ala, we're going to be starting today in mentioning levels, stages that each and every one of you needs to take to understand the Qur'an, to unlock the gems that are in this book. Before I mention these stages, I want to give you an example of maybe a verse that you may have read in the Qur'an, and sometimes people may not understand that from it. How important it is that you understand the Qur'an. ولذلك المنصور السعدي أحد ملوك المغرب he was one of the leaders of المغرب he mentioned in one of his gatherings he mentioned in one of his gatherings a question he posed to those who were sitting with him the people that were sitting with him he posed the question to them he said to them Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the ayah, فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ a person does not know, فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ No soul knows that which has been hidden for it. Meaning he is talking about Jannah. The believers in Jannah, they don't know what Allah has hidden for them. Are we all together, brothers? This is what the ayah is saying. فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ No nafs knows who's a believer, who Jannah has been promised for them. They don't know what has been what? What has been placed in Jannah. Because Jannah is مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٌ Eyes have never seen Jannah. Ears have never heard of it. And it has never come to the heart of a believer. Nobody knows about Jannah. It's something Allah hid. Pay attention to this ayah. Allah says, فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ A nafs does not know مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ The gems and the beauty that has been placed in Jannah that nafs doesn't know. This ayah used a wording. The wording that's being used here is فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ أَعْيُنٍ That's the word that's being used in the ayah. This is in Surah Sajda, ayah 17. Surah Sajda, ayah 17. The word a'yun has been used here. In the Arabic language, the word a'yun is called jumu'u qillah. Grammatically is what? Jumu'u qillah. ولذلك Ibn Malik, he says in his Alfiya, he says, أَفْعِلَةٌ أَفْعُلٌ ثُمَّ فِعْلَةٌ ثُمَّ تَأَفْعَالٌ جُمُعُ قِلَّةٌ Four are Jumu'u Qillah. Jumu'u Qillah, what does it mean? It means the numbers between 3 and what? 10. The numbers between 3 and 10. The ayah is talking about Jannah and that which has been prepared for the believers in Jannah. And we know Jannah is something big. It's something great. Why did Allah use a word a'yun which shows a small number between 3 to 10, a small figure? Why did Allah belittle the blessing of Jannah and use a little figure for it when it should have been used as a what? Something big. Does that make sense? Are we all together, brothers? Why? Al-Mansur al-Sa'di asked those who were with him. And when they couldn't answer, he said the reason is because it's لِأَنَّ اللَّهَ قَضَىٰ أَلَّا يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا The people are going to enter Jannah are what? They are people who are little in number. The people who are going to enter Jannah are not a lot. They are little in number. So this verse that you've just read, Allah chose a word that has that gem in it. Are we all together? And as you know, the majority are not guided. Allah says, وَإِن تُطْعِ أَكْثَرَ مَن فِي الْأَرْضِ يُضِلُّكَ عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ وَقَلِيلٌ مِنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ The majority are not. Are we all together, brothers? And that's why Allah chose to use, that's why Allah chose the word a'yun in this particular verse. So when you read the Quran, my beloved brothers and sisters, this is the benefit that you get from it. Brothers and sisters, just like every other science, whether it be academic science or Islamic science, there is a path for it. There is a what? There is a path for it. ولذلك الإمام مسلم بن الحجاج القشيري النيسابوري mentioned in his Sahih من حديث أبي هريرة that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم he said من سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما سهل الله به طريقا إلى الجنة Anyone who takes a path to attain what? Knowledge. Is then knowledge has a path. Knowledge is not sought the way you want. What does he have? It has a methodology. Knowledge has a what? He has a path. How is it possible the greatest of knowledge, which is the Qur'an, there's no way to study it. Of course there's a way to study it. And of course there's a methodology to study it. The Qur'an is not a novel. The Qur'an is not a journal that you read or a magazine. The Qur'an has sciences that you need to go through. And it has a methodology that you need to take. ولذلك the poet he said فما حوى الغايات في ألف سنة شخص فخذ من كل فن أحسن بحفظ متن جامع للراجح تأخذه على مفيد الناصح Knowledge has a methodology and that methodology is that you take it from a teacher a person who has knowledge ولذلك الإمام أبو داود he narrated بإسناد قوي a chain which is very strong that the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم he said من حديث ابن عباس that the messenger said تسمعون ويسمع منكم ويسمع ممن سمع منكم you will hear from me, and those who have heard from you, it will be heard from them as well. And the religion is a chain. Companions, you're going to hear from me, and there are going to be a people who are going to come, and they're going to hear it from you, and they're going to hear it from them, and they're going to hear it from them. So the same way that we took the Quran from the Prophet and we took it from the companions, we also take the meaning the same way. So inshallah ta'ala, without any further ado, I'm going to go through the stages. If you follow this methodology and you add with it su'alullah, asking Allah, وَالْإِلْحَاحِ إِلَيْهِ, and you turn back to him excessively and you beg him, inshallah ta'ala, Allah will open for you this knowledge and Allah will give you fiqh and understanding of the Quran. If you take these steps and you follow it up with الدُّعَاء وَالْإِلْحَاحِ, you beg Allah and you ask him, Allah will open it for you. وَلِذَلِكَ نُقِلَ عَنْ شَيْخِ الْإِسْلَامِ ابْنُ تَيْمِيَةِ. Ibn Taymiyyah, it was transmitted from him that if he stood over a verse and he didn't understand it properly, what would he do? He would go, يُمَرِّغُ وَجْهَهُ, he would rub his face on the earth, and then he would say, يَا مُعَلِّمَ دَاوُدُ عَلِّمْنِي وَيَا مُفَهِمَ سُلَيْمَانُ فَهِمْنِي. The one who taught Dawood, teach me, and the one who made Sulaiman understand, make me understand. So we have to ask Allah, because Allah said in the Quran, وَقُلْ رَبِّي زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. Muhammad, say, oh Allah, increase me in knowledge. So you can't attain knowledge unless you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another last point that I want to mention is, as Al-Imam Al-Zarkashi mentions in his Ulum Al-Quran book, that this science, when you compare it to all of the other sciences of the religion, it is the least served science. Ulum Al-Quran is the least served science. وَلِذَلِكَ, he said, لَمْ تَنْجُجْ وَلَمْ تَحْتَرِقْ. It's a science that was not nurtured properly and it was not cultivated. It was left and it was abandoned to an extent. And as we talk about the books and the stages that need to be taken, you will realize what we mean about the reality of this statement. It's 9 stages, but I've already taken a lot of the time. So what I will do is, inshallah ta'ala, I will mention the first 5 and I'll mention the other remaining next lesson, inshallah ta'ala, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. The first stage, if you want to learn the tafsir of the Quran and you want to gain it, the first stage is study what is called dirasatu kulliyat al-tafsir fi al-alfaz. What does it mean, dirasatu kulliyat al-tafsir fi al-alfaz? You learn, stage 1, comprehensive, where the comprehensive, I'm looking for a good English translation. Dirasa, it's to study, kulliyat al-tafsir, comprehensive principles in tafsir. First point is to study comprehensive principles in tafsir. The Quran has wordings, كلمات قرآنية التي يطرد معناها في القرآن. Wordings that you find in the Quran, and they come in the Quran, and they are always one meaning and nothing else. The first thing that you do when you want to study Quran is you learn those words. Wherever you see that word, it will mean that word. It will mean that meaning, nothing else. For example, Al-Imam Ahmad narrated في مسنده من حديث دراج أبي سمح عن أبي الهيثم عن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله تعالى عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, that the Prophet said, كل حرف يذكر فيه القنوت في القرآن فهو الطاعة. Wherever you find the word قنوت, قاف نون واو تاء, قنوت, wherever you find it in the Quran, it means طاعة, obedience. This hadith, the scholars, they dispute in its authenticity. So for example, if you read Surah Ar-Rum, Ayah 116, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, كُلُّ لَهُ قَانِتُونَ. The word قَانِت here means what? It means مُطِيعُونَ. It comes from the word ta'a, right? If you go to Surah At-Tahrim, Ayah 12, وَمَرْيَمَ ابْنَةَ عِمْرَانَ الَّتِي أَحْسَنَتْ فَرْجَعَ فَنَفَقْنَا فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِنَا وَصَدَّقَتْ بِكَلِمَاتِ رَبِّهَا وَكُتُبِهِ وَكَانَتْ مِنَ Why did Allah refer to Maryama as a male? Why did he say وَكَانَتْ مِنَ الْقَانِتِينَ And he didn't say وَكَانَتْ مِنَ الْقَانِتَاتِ You see, this is the benefit of the Qur'an. This is the tadabbur of the Qur'an. This is thinking over the Qur'an and analyzing and moving your brain. عَلَى كُلِّ حَالِ That's not what we're going to be speaking about that when we come to it. But وَكَانَتْ مِنَ الْقَانِتِينَ She was from the قانتين. Are we all together, brothers? كَانَتْ مِنَ الْقَانِتِينَ The word قانتين means what? أَيِّ الْمُطِيعِينَ Are we all together? Allah said about what? Maryam also, Ya Maryam, qunuti li rabbiki. Maryam, obey your Lord. Meaning, ati'i rabbaki. Obey your Lord. Allah says, wa man yaqnut minkunna lillahi wa rasulihi. Surah Al-Ahzab. Allah says, wa man yaqnut minkunna lillahi wa rasulihi. It means, wa man yuti' Allah wa rasulah. So the word qunut in the Quran, wherever you find it, what does it mean? It means that's the first type of, the first stage of studying tafsir. Are we all together, brothers? The book that we should study in that first stage, the book that you should do, and the book that you should look at, the book that you should study and you should look into is the kitab written by Abdul Hadi Ibn Radwan al-Abyari. Abdul Hadi Ibn Radwan al-Abyari, rahimahullah. He has a kitab called Husnul Bayan fi Nazmi Mushtarakat al-Quran. Husnul Bayan fi Nazmi Mushtarakat al-Quran. Written by Al-Allama Abdul Hadi Ibn Radwan al-Abyari al-Athari. Sheikh Saleh Ibn Abdullah Ibn Hamad al-Usaymi. Sheikh Saleh Ibn Abdullah ibn Hamad al-Usaymi, what he did was, he got that book and he worked on it. And he brought it, muhaqqaqa, musahaha, munaqqaha. He cleared it out from any mistakes and any shortcomings that were in the previous copies, and he brought out a good copy for it. This book is very good. And it is matnun shi'riyun. It's in a poetic form. It's in a what? It's in a poetic form, and it's good to study it, because when you study it, the fa'ida is you're going to learn qawa'id tafsiriyah, principles. Every time I see this word, this is what it means. This book will help you in that regard. Are we all together, brothers? That's very good. This book, it has not yaftaqidu ila sharhi wal hawashi. It requires explanation and commentary. It doesn't have it. It doesn't really have it. Except that the author himself who wrote the book, he placed some little, but it still needs explanation. Number two, the second stage. The second stage, if you want to gain and understand tafsir, is dirasatu kulliyati al-alfadhi, sorry, dirasatu gharib al-Qur'an. Dirasatu gharib al-Qur'an. The Qur'an has strange words. When we say strange meaning, it's not ordinary used on the tongue. It's غريب. الفاظ التي تخفى معانيها لقلة استعمالها. It's any wordings that is usage is very little on the tongue. It's not used a lot. It's called what? غريب. Are we all together, brothers? An example for that is, Allah says, قَدْ جَعَلَ رَبُّكِ تَحْتَكِ سَرِيَّا قَدْ جَعَلَ رَبُّكِ تَحْتَكِ سَرِيَّا What does sari mean? It means النهر قَدْ جَعَلَ رَبُّكِ تَحْتَكِ سَرِيَّا The word sari means النهر What does it mean? It means النهر because the Prophet gave that meaning to it. الإمام الطبراني narrated in his معجم الصغير أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال في قوله تعالى قد جعل ربك تحتك سرية قال السري النهر The sari is a what? A river. So this word is غريب. It's a strange word. It's not normally used on the tongue. So if you're studying tafsir, the second thing that you need to look for is to study those غريب. Those terms that are in the Quran which are, it's غريب. ولذلك the Arabic language is divided into two. Okay, as Al-Imam Abu Hayyan Al-Andalusi. Abu Hayyan Al-Andalusi is a great scholar and he's the student of who? Abu Abdullah Jamaluddin Ibn Malik. He's a student of the great Ibn Malik. He took from him what? He took from him grammar. And Abu Hayyan Al-Andalusi is a master in the Arabic grammar. But as a side benefit, Abu Hayyan Al-Andalusi, even though he was a student of Ibn Malik, he criticized his own teacher. He what? He criticized his teacher, rather he criticized his teacher's Alfiyah. And what did he say? He said, Alfiyah ibn Maliki matmusatul masaliki wa kam biha mushtaghilun awqa'a fil mahaliki. He's criticizing the great grammarian's Alfiyah. And he said, this book, its way and its method is, and how many people have studied it and it threw them into destruction. And then Ibn al-Wardi came, فَأَجَابَ مُنَافِحًا. Ibn al-Wardi came and he responded to him. He said, يَا عَائِبًا أَلْفِيَّةَ ابْنَ مَالِكِ وَغَائِبًا عَنْ حِفْظِهَا وَفَهْمِهَا أَمَا تَرَاهَا قَدْ حَوَتْ فَضَائِلًا كَثِيرَةً فَلَا تَجْرُ فِي ظُلْمِهَا وَازْجُرْ لِمَنْ جَادَلَ مَنْ يَحْفَظُهَا بِرَابِعٍ وَخَامِسٍ مِنْ اسْمِهَا. Don't criticize Alfiyah ibn Malik. ولذلك أبو حيان الأندلسي كانت في نوع حدة. He was a bit harsh, he was a harsh person. ولذلك when he met Ibn Taymiyyah, even though he liked Ibn Taymiyyah, and him and Ibn Taymiyyah were good with each other, when Ibn Taymiyyah saw harshness from him, and Ibn Taymiyyah himself was a what? He was a harsh person. ولذلك Imam al-Dhahabi said, Ibn Taymiyyah, everybody would have accepted him if he just didn't have a what? Hiddah in him. If he wasn't a bit harsh. But what Allah blessed with Ibn Taymiyyah was he had forbearance, he had hilm, even though he would tolerate people's harm. So Allah makes things. على كل حال, Abu Hayyan al-Andalusi, when he met Ibn Taymiyyah and he spoke to Ibn Taymiyyah in a harsh way, Ibn Taymiyyah got angry. And he said, you don't know this mas'ala grammar, this grammar issue that you're... And Abu Hayyan is a grammarian, he's an imam in Nahu. He said to him, even you don't know this grammar issue. Wallahi tajhaluha anta. Wallahi, you're ignorant about it. And even Sibawayhi, the father of grammar, he got mistakes in his kitab. See, but where he doesn't know he got it wrong, nor do you know Abu Hayyan al-Andalusi that he got it wrong. See, but Abu Hayyan got angry, stood up and he walked away from who? He walked away from Ibn Taymiyyah, and from that day onwards, he will never praise Ibn Taymiyyah in any gathering. Criticize him whenever he got the opportunity. Abu Hayyan has a kitab called Tahrif, Tuhfatul Arib. He has a kitab called what? Tuhfatul Arib. فيما في القرآن من الغريب. This book is very good. This book is what? It's very good. But he mentioned something that I want to mention, which is that the Arabic language is divided into how many? Two. The first thing is نوع يدركه كل أحد. A type of Arabic that everybody will understand it. When Allah said in the Quran, وَأَنزَلْنَا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً, we sent down from the sky water. Does everyone understand that? قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. Does everyone understand that? إِنَّمَا إِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ. Does everyone understand that? Father, everyone understands that. That doesn't require looking. The second type, which is what? It's نَوْعُ لَا يُدْرِكُ إِلَّا مَنْ تَبَحَّرَ فِي عُلُومِ الْعَرَبِ وَلُغَتِهِمْ. The second type is, not everyone can understand it. The only person who's going to understand it is what? A person who immersed himself deep into the Arabic language and mastered it. This is the second type, which is Dirasatu Gharib al-Quran. It's the strange words which are in the Quran. ولذلك, the book that we suggest that you should all look into if you want to study those wordings which are strange in the Quran is the book Tuhfatu al-Arib Fima fi al-Quran min al-Gharib. تحفة الأريب فيما في القرآن من الغريب. And this is by Abu Hayyan al-Andalusi rahimahullah ta'ala. And it's, as a side benefit, at the ending of his book, Abu Hayyan al-Andalusi, at the ending of his book, he mentioned the ayah أَفَلَمْ يَيْأَسِ الَّذِينَ أفلم ييأس الذين آمنوا أن لو يشاء الله لهدى الناس جميعا. Allah says, أفلم ييأس الذين. The word ييأس, it's strange, it's غريب. Abu Hayyan al-Andalusi mentions this in his Tuhfatul Arib. To be honest, he makes it at the ending of the book. What does the word أفلم ييأس mean? He brings you here في لغة النخا. There's a tribe within the Arabs which is called, it's a language and a dialect of the people of Nakha. They use this word, أَفَلَمْ يَيْأَسْ. The word يَيْأَسْ to them, it meant what? It meant يَعْلَمْ وَيَبِينْ. يَعْلَمْ وَيَبِينْ. Meaning, did they not know? أَفَلَمْ يَعْلَمِ الَّذِينَ. That's what it means. أَفَلَمْ يَيْأَسِ الَّذِينَ. Are you with me, brothers? It's good to study غريب القرآن. And the benefit of studying, غريب القرآن is, you will not speak about the Qur'an incorrectly, and you will not interpret the Qur'an in a way that's not befitting to it. The third one that I'm going to conclude with for today, it's nine stages, but we're going to mention the third and we'll stop there inshaAllah ta'ala, is دِرَاسَةُ كَرِمَاتِ الْقُرْآنِ. The third one is studying the Qur'an word for word. Word for word. And the difference between this one and the غريب القرآن is, the غريب القرآن is restricted to the strange words in the Qur'an. Whereas this one, it's every single wording in the Qur'an. If you can't explain every single wording in the Qur'an, you don't know the tafsir of the Qur'an. You need to know it word for word. دراسة كلمات القرآن. Word for word. And the example for this is Allah تبارك وتعالى when He said, in the ayah, وَعِنْدَهُ مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ لَا يَعْلَمُهَا إِلَّا هُوَ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ وَمَا تَسْقُطُ مِنْ وَرَقَةٍ إِلَّا يَعْلَمُهَا وَلَا حَبَّةٍ فِي ظُلُمَاتِ الْأَرْضِ وَلَا رَطْبٍ وَلَا يَابِسٍ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ. وَعِنْدَهُ مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ. مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ means what? The keys of the unseen are what? الإمام البخاري narrated in his صحيح من حديث ابن شهاب عن سالم بن عبد الله بن عمر عن أبيه عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, that the Prophet said, مفاتح الغيب خمسون. It's five. The Prophet explained it word. What are they? إن الله عنده علم الساعة. Allah knows the knowledge of the hour. ويعلم الغيث. Allah knows when the rain comes down. ويعلم ما في الأرحام. Allah knows what is in the womb of the mother. وما تدري نفس ماذا تكسب غدا. No soul knows what they're going to gain tomorrow. وما تدري نفس بأي أرض تموت. And no one knows where they're going to die. That's the key of the unseen. The book that you should read if you want to know the Quran word for word is كلمات القرآن توضيح وبيان. كلمات القرآن توضيح وبيان. And it's written by للعلامة الحسنين ابن محمد مخلوف المالكي الأزهري رحمه الله. This كتاب is مختصر نافع. Very beneficial book. And it really explains for you the Quran word for word. Again, this book, it needs someone to explain it. There's no written sharah for it. And this is another indication of what I was mentioning before, which is علم التفسير في الأمة قليل وعزيز. The knowledge of tafsir is really not a science that was served properly. When it really is what? When it really is the best of science. It's the best of science. I'll conclude there inshaAllah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Any questions?
Ah. 70 nations or 7 nations after? 70
nations. Tutimuna 70. Antum khayruha wa akramuha ala Allahi. Mm-hmm. Ha. Yeah? Ha. We're going to come to that. That's it falls under another example for us. Dhulm is not. Dhulm will enter into dirasat al-wujuh wal-nadha'iq. We'll speak about that next lesson. It doesn't fall under the types that we mentioned. Dhulm is different. Ha. Huh? The six reasons why we learn the Qur'an. The first one is al-qira'ah, to read the Qur'an. The second one is al-tadabbur, is to ponder on the Qur'an. The third one is al-amalu bihi, to implement it. The fourth one is al-hukm wa al-tahakumi ilayh. And the fifth one, it was five. And the fifth one is al-istishfa'u bihi, to look for cure in it. It's five, sorry. I by accident say six. Huh? That falls under the first one, which is to read it. Any other question? Huh. The first book that we mentioned that the person should read if he wants to learn the principles of the Quran. What was the first book that we mentioned? حسن البيان في نظم مشتركات القرآن. Who did we say the author was? للعلامة عبد الهادي ابن رضوان الأبياري رحمه الله. The second book that we said was what? غريب القرآن تحفة الأريب فيما في القرآن من الغريب. And it's written by أبو حيان الأندلسي رحمه الله تعالى. And the third book that we, the third one we mentioned is دراسة كليات دراسة كلمات القرآن. That we said it is كلمات القرآن توضيح وبيان, written by حسنين ابن مخلوف المالكي الأزهري رحمه الله. Brothers, wallahi, you have to give importance to the Quran. This Quran, there's nothing like it, brothers, wallahi. وبعد فحبل الله فينا كتابه فجاهد به حبل العدا متحبلا وأخلق به إذ ليس يخلق مثله وأخلق به إذ ليس يخلق جدة جديد مواليه على الجد مقبلا وقارئه المرضي قر مثاله كالأترج حاليه مريحا وموكلا هو المرتضى أمن إذا كان أمة. This book is the best. There's nothing like it. It's the treasures. Wallahi, every book you read, if you finish it once and you read it again, it gets boring. But the Quran, every Ramadan Taraweeh, when you hear it, it's like you heard it the first time. How many verses did you read? And then the first time you actually took this fiqh from it, you're like, is this what this ayah was saying all this time? Why did I not see it? Sah? Because Shatibi mentions it, وَخَيْرُ جَلِيسٍ لَا يُمَلُّ حَدِيثُهُ وَتَرْدَادُهُ يَزْدَادُ فِيهِ تَجَمُّلًا. It's the best thing to sit with. And it's the best thing to spend your time with. And guess what? If you spend time with the Qur'an and it becomes your friend, وَخَيْرُ جَلِيسٍ لَا يُمَلُّ حَدِيثُ. You don't become tired of the conversation with the Qur'an. وَتَرْدَادُ. Every time you read it, تَزْدَادُ فِيهِ تَجَمُّلًا. The beauty increases. It just becomes more beautiful. You know clothes, the more you wear it, what happens to it? It wears out. The Qur'an, the more it's read, the more it shines. Sahih? ولذلك عبد الله بن مسعود he said من أراد علم الأولين والآخرين فليثور القرآن. أما he said فليثور القرآن, let him read the Quran, أي فلينظر إلى القرآن, let him look at the Quran and let him reset inside the Quran. فإن في علم الأولين والآخرين, because in the Quran is the knowledge of the early people and the ones to come. But we'll together brothers. ولذلك we have not fallen into what we fell into, the disputes, the argumentations, the khilafat, the enmity, the hate, the everything that we see that we're going through, we fell into this when we turned away from the Book of Allah. We fell into all of this when we turned away from the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we'll only gain what we once upon a time had, the glory and the victory that we once had, when we what? When we go back to the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to You have to study it, inshallah ta'ala. But لذلك Ibn Taymiyyah, when he went to prison and he was in his prison and his, they took all of his pens from him and they took every books from him and they just, he had to read Quran. And what did he read? The only thing he had to read was the Quran. And he read the Quran from his memorization, from his hifz. And he finished the Quran 80, 182, 83. I've seen all those figures. And then he died on the ayah, إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي جَنَّاتٍ وَنَهَرٍ فِي مَقْعَدِ صِدْقٍ عِنْدَ مَلِيكٍ مُقْتَدِرٍ. That's where he died. And Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said, if I was to know the gems and the jewels in the Quran, I would not have spent my time with anything other than the Quran. And it is sad that a person claims to be a student of knowledge and he wants to learn the religion, but he's not given no importance to the Quran. That's very, very bad. It's bad if you don't learn the Quran. This is the word of Allah. Imagine we have the kalam of Allah, Allah's speech, Allah. His speech is amongst us, it's in us, we have it. We have a characteristics of Allah here. Which is what? The speech of Allah, is it not the characteristics of Allah? We have it amongst ourselves. And it's collecting dust. I remember one time, one of the greatest mashayikh, I went to his library, was Sheikh Hamad al-Ansari. Sheikh Hamad al-Ansari, he had the biggest, but he has a big library. So his library is sometimes open for the students of knowledge. And it's the biggest library I've ever seen. Are we all together, brothers? Sheikh Hamad al-Ansari, he was the Saudi government, they used to give him money to just travel the world and to collect manuscripts. That's what his job was, nothing else. That's all his work. So he used to go to all over the world to collect manuscripts and to collect books. That's his job. That was his title. I went to his library. And when I walked in, his son said something very powerful to me. Abdul Bari, he said to me, all of this, it stems from the Mus'haf. Sorry? This whole library, what is it all? It's the Mus'haf. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illallah astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.